Thank you very much. This is a great moment. You guys look like the Munich Security Conference 2017. Tomorrow afternoon at about the same time, unfortunately, most of the faces will look like 30 years older. But I'm so pleased to see that this attempt, which we started a couple of years ago, this attempt to open the conference to a broader public, to younger people, has been so successful. I think this can really be called a sold-out preview event. So I'm a very happy organizer. Now, the theme of this year's conference, we chose to say, with question marks, post-truth, post-West, and maybe post-order. Very complex and difficult issues. Today, this session is mostly focused on the post-truth, on the fake, news issue, and what it means to our societies, to a functioning democracy, and how we can and we probably are being manipulated. Now, manipulation is not an invention of the 21st century, but the methods by which we are being manipulated are, of course, a lot more sophisticated, much more intense, and that's why they deserve to be discussed with a wonderful group of experts. I don't want to keep this event from starting right now. Let me simply say that I think the conference beginning tomorrow afternoon promises to be quite a historic one, because when this event started more than 50 years ago, it started as a purely German-American discussion about such issues as keeping the Soviets out, about nuclear weapons, American nuclear weapons, and what to do with them or what not to do with them in the European theater. This year, for all the reasons that you are familiar with, I think we are going to see that our central theme of this weekend is, again, you know, not so much what's going on in China, which we are, of course, also going to be discussing, but I think the central theme is the future of the transatlantic relationship. We have so many question marks. Many of you, many of us, have so many question marks, unanswered questions, worries, concerns, and I hope that by Sunday lunchtime, when I will have the pleasure of concluding the conference at about lunchtime, I hope that people will leave the conference with a sense that at least some of the question marks have been eliminated, hopefully, a little bit more clarity reestablished, and by recreating more clarity, I would imagine that we would all feel hopefully slightly more secure again. So this is important. And I don't think we've had a more important Munich Security Conference in many years. So this is a great, great moment. I'm going to hand this over now to Julian Reichelt, before he takes over, whom I want to congratulate on his new ascension to be the Tsar of the editors-in-chief of the Bild-Zeitung Empire. Those of you who are not German will know that there is nothing in German media journalism that has the same reach as does the Bild-Zeitung. So don't get cross with Julian. You will probably live to regret it. He will, of course, introduce his lineup of speakers. I'm really impressed that we were able to get for this event a day even before the opening day of the conference, such a wonderful group of panelists. So Julian, congratulations to you, and enjoy the afternoon. This is a very, very interesting event. Thank you very much.
Well, it looks like I'm now supposed to deliver remarks. I wasn't told about that. I was told that I would start over there with all you on the panel, so I will start to improvise. Thank you very much, Ambassador Ischinger, for your very kind words and the very charming description of Bild and how we react to criticism. I can say that, you know, even if you do cross me, you have nothing to fear from me. We have developed into a very kind organization. I'm very, very honored to be here with this great panel today. Ambassador Ischinger has said that it possibly is the most important Munich Security Conference in years. The truth is, that's what he says every year. And the truth is, every year he's right. The timing of this conference is, I think, a major part of what makes it such a great event. I don't know what it is about February or the beginning of the year. People always talk about the guns of August, that this is that August is the decisive month for world history. But if I look at this conference, it also seems to be February, because I have never been here without a major event going on, without major talks, without historic events, without tragic events. Last year, I think on the eve of the Munich Security Conference, a deal was reached here, unfortunately called the Munich Agreement in the media, on peace for Syria. Now we have kind of a peace in Syria, but that resulted out of the end of the city of Aleppo. So there were always historic things taking place here, and it is a historic place and a historic forum. So I'm very honored to be here today and kind of be the first speaker, and even being surprised by being the first speaker. And what kind of dominates my everyday life now is I always listen to National Public Radio in the morning on my Amazon system. And whenever I turn on NPR in the morning, it seems like it's traveling back in time, because what I always hear when I turn it on is the Russians. They always talk about the Russians every day, and that is something that hasn't happened in a while, and it kind of tells you that there really is a new kind of confrontation that today is not so much being fought with nuclear weapons, although they're still there and still being discussed. And using them is being discussed more than ever before, but it's fought on a mainly digital battlefield, and one of the major weapons of this battlefield is the weapon of fake news and disinformation that has existed before, but it's being spread more sophisticatedly than ever before. And I'm very happy to discuss that with my great panel today, that now I have the honor of introducing again. I wasn't prepared to do that, but since I'm here now, I'm happily do that. I will start with ladies first, with Fiona Hill, Director of Center of the United States and Europe at the Brookings Institution in Washington, D.C. Very warm welcome to you, and please join us on the stage. The great thing about this panel, by the way, is that I have a personal relation with all of the panelists, although some of them don't know that. I will now introduce General David Petraeus. I first met him covering the war in Iraq, then met him covering the war in Afghanistan. I have a patch from him from the 101st Airborne Division. Today he's in Washington, D.C. at KKRA. Very warm welcome to you, sir. Please join us on the stage. My relation with Scott Carpenter is that the company Bild, that publishes Bild, Axel Springer has very warm relations with Google, and we've said a lot of nice things about each other. And I think by now we really have become friends, and I have a Gmail account, so which seem, you know, may sound funny, but it has become relevant because, you know, Gmail is one of the prime targets of the people we will be discussing now. So Scott Carpenter, Managing Director of Google Jigsaw, I welcome you on the stage. Please join us here. I will read the title of my next guest because I don't want to mess it up and it's kind of long. His name is Gerhard Conrad, and he is the director of the Intelligence Analysis and Situation Center at the European External Action Service of the European Union in Brussels. That sounds long and may sound kind of bureaucratic. He is kind of a hero of my, I don't want to say my childhood, but my youth, because his former title, which sounds way more glamorous, was Mr. Hezbollah. He was an operative in the BND, and some people say that he was involved in prisoner swaps and all kind of crazy spy game deals that were made in the Middle East, that he may have been or not been present at some of those deals. So it's great to have you here, Mr. Conrad. Please join us up here. Georg Mascolo sitting down there lonely, a wonderful colleague. He is the head of the Rechercheverbund of NDR, WDR and Süddeutsche Zeitung, one of our Bild's fiercest competitors, and probably one of the best investigative journalists of our country. He pretends to be surprised by this, but he knows he is, because he has been for a while, and you can tell when Mr. Conrad and Georg Mascolo greet each other that they have known for quite a while. And Peter Mascolo may have been present at one of the events Georg Mascolo, not Peter, I'm sorry. I've been present at one of the events I described earlier, so Georg, welcome to you. Please join us up here. So, I will start with you, Scott, and a personal anecdote from 2 days ago. I logged into my Gmail account, and it said, I got a red flashing notice, and it said that a state actor may be trying to hack into my account, which is kind of concerning, but at least they showed me that note, and now I have the two-factor identification and all that. So I was thinking about that, and since we will be talking about the digital battlefield, I was wondering, if that scenario that someone really manages to hack into Google Mail isn't one of the doomsday scenarios of our times, because pretty much every personal relation that exists in the world is somehow documented within Google Mail. And if that would have been attacked and made searchable for everyone, it would possibly end a lot of human personal relations. So what are you trying what are you doing to protect against that major threat to basically everyone using that service?
Well, first of all, I will get to the answer to that question, that very important question, in a second, but I did want to take a moment just to thank the organizers for having me here. I'm really excited to be in Munich. I want to thank you all for the amazing weather that you have provided. I want to thank you as well for giving me the honor and privilege of wearing a suit and a tie. Not something I do on a day-to-day basis, I can assure you. And I also want to say that I want to thank the organizers. You didn't know it, of course, but this is the first annual anniversary of my team at Google called Jigsaw. And I'm sure you've heard a lot about Google. Most of you've heard about Google, right? But probably fewer of you have heard about Jigsaw. So about a year ago, Jigsaw was formed at Google. We were formerly Google Ideas. We are an incubator at Google where we you have engineers, product managers, designers, a large capacity of folks who are looking to use our technology and other technologies to keep people safe online against a range of different sorts of international global security challenges. So digital attacks, which will bring me back to the Gmail, mitigating online toxicity in terms of how we communicate with one another online, thinking about how we also combat kind of online violent extremism and how we think about that challenge, among a number of other security challenges. So clearly I am on the right panel, clearly. So first of all, let me ask everybody in the audience just to raise their hand, how many of you use Gmail? Okay.
The now, Russians are taking a picture now.
Now, and this is an important second question, how many of you have enabled two-step verification? Okay, for those, there are a lot fewer hands that went up to that second question. It is really important, especially since a picture was just taken, that you go and you enable two-step verification. Two-step verification will keep you safe so that when you, if you are privileged, and very few people are privileged, to get that warning that Google puts out there, the government-backed attack alert, you will be safe. And I want to clarify that when you get that alert, it's just a way of raising your attention to your own security. Google's got your back, so you are protected, but we want you to take that additional step to enable two-factor verification because it will protect you from a wide variety of attacks, digital attacks. The other point I want to make for those of you who have two-factor verification enabled is to get a security key. You can learn more about those online and on your Google account if you take a look there. But security keys are very simple devices that will make sure that even if you get something that looks like Google and you enter your password inadvertently, that you won't be able to even put your password in. It won't let you do it. So with those prophylactics in place, you'll be kept safe. I want to talk about just very quickly a couple of other areas that we've been looking at. I mentioned digital attacks. One of the challenges that we look at is censorship, repressive censorship. And one of the kind of easiest ways to censor a news organization today is through what's called a DDoS attack. Does anybody not know what a DDoS attack is? Just raise your hand, don't be shy. There are a couple hesitant hands going up. Okay, a DDoS attack is basically you inviting, let's say, you're gonna have a dinner party with a couple people, you're gonna come over to your apartment for dinner. And instead of those two people arriving at your apartment for dinner, 100,000 show up, okay? Now, it ruins, the guests that want to get there can't get there because there's all this kind of traffic all around your apartment. People in your building are upset. They can't make their way up the stairs. And so in this instance, in a digital DDoS attack, the idea is that unwanted traffic to your site overwhelms your legitimate visitors and silences your site. And increasingly, this is the tactic of choice to censor. It's very, very inexpensive and cheap. And so one of the things that we're doing at Jigsaw is called Project Shield. And what we enable are any independent publishers to sign up for this free service that protects them from that kind of attack. And those types of attacks happen at the very moment that news and information are the most critical for people to get. So around the time of elections, when people are trying to communicate what's going on, for example, and that's happened in a number of countries around the world. So Jigsaw is really trying to grapple with these sorts of challenges, and I hope we get to talk about some of the other solutions to some of the challenges that we're going to raise on this panel today. Thanks, Julian.
General Petraeus, many fascinating points we heard here. You have been an observer of the digital battlefield for years. It was a phenomenon back in Iraq already. It devolved into a way more sophisticated one in Afghanistan. Obviously, you have dealt with that as the director of the Central Intelligence Agency. What is the biggest threat that you are seeing out there?
Well, great question. Thanks, and great to be with you, Julian, and all the others on the stage. And Ambassador, I think this is a very special gathering. I was just thinking, as you went through that, about being here back in 2009, at the start of another American administration, another so-called inflection point. I remember Richard Holbrooke was my diplomatic wingman for that particular endeavor. And there was a great sense of anticipation and a degree of uncertainty as well. There is obviously that this time, but I think even more so, given the ensuing 8 years and all that's taken place in the world, in this region, as well as obviously in the Middle East, out in the Far East, and then obviously with the domestic developments in the United States. So I think you actually have got it right this time, even though you do say it every year. And it is great to be back for it. Look, I think that the real threat that is out there has to do with the vulnerability of the so-called industrial control systems, the SCADA systems, that operate our electrical grid, our water systems, and so forth, in any of the advanced countries. And they're generally yesterday's technology, and you don't generally have in a lot of these municipalities or even state and local areas necessarily the kind of talent that you find at Google Ideas now, Jigsaw. And this is enormously important because we have individual or groups out there that we know, it's publicly known that nation states have conducted cyber reconnaissance of our electrical grid in the United States. Assuming that is the case, and again, that has been verified publicly, the concern is extremist groups, particularly Islamic extremists, because they've shown a willingness on the battlefield to kill themselves, to take us with them. And that's pretty tough to deter if there's that kind of spirit. So whereas with a nation state actor, there's a return address, there's a degree of deterrent effect, even though the developments in cyberspace have really outstripped the ability of theorists to come up with any kind of sophisticated concepts the way the wizards of Armageddon did in the nuclear age over a number of decades. Here it's just advancing month on month, if not more rapidly. And the idea that, again, extremists could have the cyber equivalent of a weapon of mass destruction, in other words, the ability to take down an electrical grid for a portion of, say, the United States or another advanced industrialized country and keep it down, that is a fairly terrifying thought. A number of us in the east of the United States, at least, remember the New York blackout of a few decades back. It was really a horrific experience. I remember the hurricane that hit the East Coast and how tough that was. Think of an ability to take it down and then keep it down, and the effect that that has, and the enormous ramifications for life and limb. Given the lack of emergency systems shutting down, again, over time, even emergency capabilities are going to go out, as we saw, say, with the hurricane in New Orleans some years back. That, again, is a very, very scary thought, and there's really a race ongoing to improve the capabilities of the cybersecurity of these industrial control systems, and that's a race that we've got to win.
Fiona, General Petraeus has now talked about mainly threats to infrastructure. What do you see as the main threats to the social fabric of our Western liberal societies coming out of disinformation and hacking and the spreading of fake news?
You know, I was thinking as Ambassador Ishiger was looking out at the audience and saying tomorrow it looked like it was 30 years ago, that actually 30 years ago was another year of living dangerously. We've been very much worrying about 2017 as a revolutionary period. Both in the United States and with all the elections coming here, as we heard from the opening film. And 1983, a little bit more than 30 years, was another of those periods as well. And what makes it very similar to here was we had this kind of brinkmanship in international relations. We had a major rift between Europe and the United States over how to handle the Soviet Union. There was a risk of nuclear war, real risk of nuclear war. Many people on the panel will remember that there had been an actual war scare in 1983. The Soviet Union was actually on the alert, thinking that the United States was going to launch a first strike. And the Soviet Union seemed to be ever present in politics. You know, this is the Reagan era, there were all kinds of influence operations. And there was just a lack of trust in institutions at the time. And I think that that is a lesson for this period as well. That disinformation, fake news, they've been around for an extraordinarily long time. We're celebrating this year, if celebrating is really the right word to use, the 100th anniversary of the Russian Revolution. The Russian government actually is being very careful about this. They don't really want to celebrate it. It's not the best occasion to remember the collapse of a state. And as we know from President Putin's appearance here 10 years ago, another anniversary, you know, he made it very clear that Russia wasn't into revolutions again in the same way as before. And what did we see in that period? An awful lot, again, of use of information, of news in a revolutionary environment. The collapse of a state in a critical period where there's a lot of divisions. And I think that fake news and information has the most destructive impact when there are many divisions within a society, when there's lots of political differences, and we're at a period where there's a lot of trust lost in institutions. And we're definitely, as everybody's been saying, at that kind of inflection point. We've been there before, but what we now have, as we're talking about here, is different tools. The kind of things that Trotsky was running around with agitprop, he had to take a train and get off and actually do performances with people. You don't need to do that now when you can use Twitter. It's a heck of a lot more efficient. Imagine what Trotsky would be doing if he was around today. And you know, frankly, the Bolsheviks were peddling misinformation and disinformation to, you know, basically promote their cause. So I think we've got to start thinking about this in old ways. Okay, new tools, but it's an old problem. And we have to put back the faith in information and trust in our institutions. And frankly, the media plays an important role here. Institutions like this, you know, why are we here? Are we having frank discussions? Are people basically giving an analysis that's based on something that's objective and is not highly politicized? I mean, this is the kind of important kinds of discussions that we have to have now. We have to find a way of putting a new generation of people back in a sense of trust in the institutions and in the people who represent them. And that's going to be very difficult. But we did do it back in the 1980s, after a period in which we lost our direction for a while.
So we've heard a lot, and now mentioned a lot, fake news. But another phenomenon we're seeing is real news that is based on hacking. And the number one facilitator for real news based on hacking has been the media, Georg. We have done a lot to spread news that is relevant, that may be important, like many of the stories we saw in the DC leaks hacking campaign, but that still serve an agenda. Have we not done enough to tell our readers about that agenda behind the hacked information we have spread and worked into our news stories? And do we need a debate if it's legitimate to use this kind of information at all, if we know or have a pretty good idea that it comes out of a state-sponsored group that is hacking it to create what Fiona just described as division in our societies? Are we hurting ourselves if we spread this kind of information by running it in news stories?
Well, I mean, this is a question, of course, as we say, for strategic communication. Yeah? It's a question of communication, which is, as you know, not necessarily my present remit. We, of course, at the INSEN, the EU INSEN, analyze more or less the risks and the threat emanating from the actions described, and I can only pass the question whether we have done enough, or what we are going to do, or we're supposed to do. I may pass then to better qualified, let's say, colleagues from the media and from the information policy. My turn is only just to say that we in Brussels look very carefully on the different kind, the scope and the nature of the threats emanating from the, I call it, brave new world, the brave new technological world. I mean, it is a trend. Let's say experts have been monitoring since at least a decade. It's more than a decade. It's 1.5 to 2 decades. And that's the emergence of what we call then very often the cyber world. The cyber world in which very many practical realities of our life, our daily life, are being influenced or even determined. And that to an increasing degree, and especially for the so-called younger generation, this is your future. Yeah. And you probably won't evade and can't avoid that kind of future, which will be very, very largely play in the virtual world, in the cyber world, to whom I tell it. I'm born before computer, a BBC guy, so in that regard, it's a difference. But we will have to be very careful not only vigilant, but then very active on two fields. The one is a technical, and General Petraeus very, very clearly said it, and who is more, let's say, apt to say it and to know about it, that one vital basis for our survival is an intact infrastructure, an intact and unharmed and a performant vital infrastructure in all of the countries. And due to the links and the interwoven nature now, be it in Europe but also on the global level of infrastructure, and say if you destroy it or seriously harm it in one place, the risk of a kind of a technological domino effect is quite high. It has to be tackled. It has to be understood. It has to be tackled. It's one element. The other one, which more relates to the question we have today and this afternoon, is the truth. The question, what is the truth? I mean, frankly speaking, this is really, as you said, it's an age-old question. What is the truth? The truth is, cynically speaking, what you like. So the subjectivism of human creatures has always been here. It's nothing of this year. It's not related to the last 100 years. It's an everlasting problem. It's a cognitive problem. But nowadays, with the means, for the first time, I dare to say let's say human history, people can create their own world. Not necessarily only relying on one or two media outlets, even let's say the strongest ones, as for example the Bild Zeitung or similar ones.
Although I want to point out that we do not create our own world, that we leave that to
But let's say it's a question of information and Weltbild, as we say, the understanding, let's say the parameters in which you understand your personal reality and then the wider reality. And the wider and the more distant reality is, the more you don't feel it. You have to rely on media, whatever the media are. And during the last 10 to 20 years, now you have a huge, let's say, scope of realities in the market to buy, to consume, to believe. So the choice, the ability to choose and to create your own world, your own orbit, either in individually or then in a group dynamics, a smaller group, a larger group, is unparalleled and unrivaled. And this kind of fragmentation, it's a social science question as well. This kind of fragmentation is in fact something which can be and is being exploited by everybody who wants to, you know, have influence. We need not to point with fingers then to certain, let's say, actors, be it state actors or others. There are a multitude of actors, and there will be even more. So this is the major, this is a major challenge we have, not pointing to, as we say, our dear neighbor in the East or neighbors wheresoever, let's say, state actors, but also conglomerates, influential, let's say, technologically influential actors. So the best is really to speak about state actors, yes, but non-state actors with their own interests, be it malign, be it benign, that's another question, but actors who are shaping, trying to shape the world, and the means for shaping and establishing alternative truth is, as I said, unparalleled, and we have to tackle with that on several levels. The first one is establishing of facts, trying to establish facts, trying to come close to something like truth, and then, of course, making use of that. That's then the stratcom thing.
Well, to everyone in the audience who is here for the first time, this tells you about the very high level of competence here at the MSC that pretty much every panelist can answer every question, because that initially was a question for Georg, but, you know, having two Germans on the panel with so similar names, you know, you gave a brilliant answer, so thank you for that. But let me let me redirect that question to Georg, because it is about our profession. It is about journalists spreading not fake news, but real news that come out of leaks. Do we need a debate how we use that kind of material? How we use material that was taken out of someone's email account, possibly by a state actor?
Well, usually journalists get invited to Munich Security Conference and these kind of panels because they are not known for an overly optimistic worldview. So I suppose my role is now to convince you that fake news, disinformation, and gigantic leaks will push the world further to the brink. First, I love that we have these kind of discussions now in such a setting because I think they are of the utmost importance. And my second observation would be that we should think about what is really new and what are those developments which are well known. Fake news always existed. Politicians who were lying always existed. What is probably new in the United States is that usually you had politicians who lied when it came to something very serious, Nixon and Watergate, Ronald Reagan and Iran-Contra. Now we might have a president who is ready to lie for very small things. This is probably not.
And very small crowds.
And when I think about disinformation, when I was a young reporter based in the former GDR and then the wall came down, we spent years and years trying to find out what the East German intelligence services, the Stasi, did. And they had a whole department for nothing else than fake news and disinformation. They had hundreds and hundreds of people working there. One of their examples was, for example, when they intercepted a phone call from the then Chancellor Helmut Kohl with a high-ranking party member. They took the intercepted phone call and they put it in an American form and then leaked it to the German press, saying that here the Americans are intercepting the German government. I have to say that back then we were convinced that they wouldn't.
That would never happen.
Today it wouldn't be news anyway. So we are well known to all this. But when I remember those days, it was pretty hard to get fake news and disinformation out because you had the gatekeepers, the journalists. And I wouldn't say that we always do a good job. I would even argue that we have to do a much better job than we usually does. But there were those gatekeepers. Today, as you all know, these gates doesn't exist any longer. And the truth is traveling with the same speed a lie is. And what is making things even more complicated is that there are a lot of people out there who probably know that this news they're consuming is not as fact-checked, as thoroughly researched, sent it by a huge journalistic brand like the New York Times, because sometimes they go to other news because they want to believe it, or they think it's juicy, or they think it's more entertaining. What is good in the discussion we are having in these days and we are having here is that I think that we all discovered that the most important critical infrastructure we have is our democracy. Mm-hmm. And that our democracy is under attack by whoever is involved in this game, and that trust and truth are the rock, the foundation of every educated discussion, if it's about politics, the society, or the economy. And this is something we have to protect, and I think we all have to do a better job in doing so. And with this, I don't want to duck your question, how to deal with these kind of gigantic leaks. There's still a heavy debate going on in the American press if they went too far by publishing the DNC mails. What the American press did, in my observation, for weeks and months, that they said that we are going to report on this material because it is in the public interest. But we very clearly say and write about the suspicion that this was leaked by Russian intelligence services with the help of WikiLeaks. The first question every journalist has to answer if you use any kind of leaked material, and leaked material is around since there is journalism. You know, back in, I would say, the old days, nobody was sending you millions and millions of diplomatic cables or the Panama Papers or DNC leaks. Usually somebody told you a story, or then you could photocopy certain documents, and then you got a couple of documents. Now we are very often dealing with, really, with literally with hundreds of thousands or millions of documents. I don't believe in the idea of simply publishing it all. We are not in the business of dumping material. We have to thoroughly research and find out if there is really a public interest or not. When we published the Panama Papers last year, we had a huge argument with WikiLeaks, who strongly criticized us because we refused to simply publish the Panama Papers as a whole, which we wouldn't do because there is simply no public interest in all the documents. There is a lot of public interest in it. So this is the first question, which is an old question we always have to answer. And the second is, if you really think, or if there is proof that your source is an intelligence service, I have to say I would be very, very careful. And this is not excluding for a Russian intelligence service. This is a general remark and a general observation. When I think that, let's say 15 years ago, somebody from Stasi disinformation department would approach you and telling you that they have some very interesting documents, do you want to publish it or not? You would probably have said, no. That's why they usually circumvented, so they recruited either journalists or they sent it through other channels so that those who were going to publish the material simply don't know where they came from. So I think we will have some very tough questions to answer as journalists. And I think there will be moments in the future where this kind of material will show up and journalists will simply refuse to work with it due to the source of the material.
John Petraeus, I saw you nodding heavily and taking notes when Georg Mascolo was talking. I will get back to what you wrote on there right away. Just have a brief question to Scott before that, since we, I think, all agree that the whole concept of facts and truth is under heavy attack. What can an organization like Google, that combines and collects so much knowledge and so much about what people want to know and care about, what can an organization like Google do to reestablish the concept of facts and truth? Although it's probably a nightmare to some people that Google decides what truth is, but when it comes to facts, what can Google do to protect and defend the concept of facts?
Okay, I'm going to describe two possible, I wouldn't say solutions, but again, to mitigate the problem. But before I do, it's audience participation time again. I want to ask each of you how, when you think about the news that you consume, how many of you can explore and read five different sources on any given story in your own language? Five. Raise your hand. Okay, very few. How many of you, I'll lower the number, consider sources on the same story from multiple languages? And I would say English and, let's say, French or even Chinese. Okay. So I want to get into the two ideas. One is we worked on something that we call unfiltered news, unfiltered.news, and if you go there, you can check it out. But the idea is that we all live within our filter bubbles. We know that. And the challenge is, as has been discussed, is that once we're in them, we want to go deeper into them. So I have a really good friend. He loves MSNBC. If you know that channel, it's become the voice of the resistance in some ways in the US. And so I said, look, when you're watching, that's great, but you should also watch Fox News to better understand, you know, the complexity of the situation. And he said, tongue in cheek, he said, no, thank you. I don't want my preconceptions challenged. Okay. So the point is that none of us like our preconceptions challenged, so we have to work at it. And we created this visualization in a way to let you see what the rest of the world is talking about, so that you can see what are the top 10 news stories in your country versus what are the top 10 stories elsewhere in the world. And you can get them in your own language right away, whether it's China or the United States or in Russian even. And the idea is to try to challenge us to explore outside of our silos. This is something that we all have to educate ourselves about. We have to be less lazy. We have to seek the truth if we want to pretend that it still exists, right? In terms of facts, so facts are really, really important. But to my friend's point, preconceptions are also really important. Emotion is very important, but we do need to do a better job at facts. And we at Google don't want to be determining what facts are either. So one of the things we did do, though, is we worked with the fact-checking organizations from around the world, and there are 165 of them, and with Duke University, who kind of runs a fact-checking program for those trainings for those fact-checkers. But the problem with fact-checking was each individual newspaper does it, and in order to find the facts, you have to go to that site to get the facts, and no one is going to do that. And so what we encouraged them to do was use a data schema, a machine-readable schema, so now in Google News, and if you search in Google for news, if there is a fact-check by any organization that has put out this fact check, it will surface in the results. And what we hope is that more organizations will use that data schema to do their fact checking because it's eminently tweetable, it's easily findable, and it adds context for the news that we're consuming. Do I think that fact checking will change everybody's minds? No. But It is a check. It causes you to reflect on whether or not this story is accurate, what you're reading. So I think that those two ideas of finding ways to use technology to break silos online and to also accelerate the ability to bring facts to the higher to the surface when we're looking for news are both really important.
General Petraeus, we've now heard that there's always been fake news, and what's new is the speed it's spreading with. How do you explain that? What is, for example, social media doing to the spreading of fake news?
Let me try to put this in a little bit bigger context, and actually it sort of comes back again to Ambassador Issinger talking about the strategic context. 3 weeks ago, I spent 3 hours in a hearing with the House Armed Services Committee talking about the state of the world. And essentially, the bottom line is that, in my view, the institutions, the organizations, the norms, and so forth, that have stood the world in pretty good stead since World War II, are really under strain, stress, even attack, in a way that they have not been before. And you know, these have stood us again, as I said, in quite good stead, especially if you compare the second half of the 20th century with the first half, in which you had two horrible world wars and the worst economic depression in global history. So up till this point in time, they generally held in there during the Cold War, during a variety of other challenges. But now you have number of revisionist powers out there. Russia certainly is among them, Iran. China, for the United States, is both our biggest trading partner and a strategic competitor. That is indeed putting strain on the system again that they have enjoyed such extraordinary progress under, but now want to see revised and modified to accommodate their desires for rising influence, some of which very legitimate, some of which are much more challenging to ideals and ways of life that we hold very dear. So you have that to begin with. And again, a lot of it is about different systems. These are not powers that celebrate, again, the same ideals that for all these decades have always been cherished at the Munich Security Conference. And then on top of that, you add the real undermining of trust that was talked about here earlier in institutions in the very fabric of our society, democracy, the foundation, if you will, of all that many of us cherish. And yes, it's always been there. There's always been propaganda, you know, the earlier name for fake news. But what is different now is, of course, the way that this can be amplified in such an efficient manner. That's the big difference. And the way that those who are more skillful in cyberspace and in the use of tools on the internet can employ trolling, can harness all kinds of other, you know, when you get to a distributed denial of services attack, the latest one used all of these Internet of Things devices, harnessed them together because they have very poor cybersecurity in many cases, to actually take down one of the most important digital switchboards, the internet switchboard, for a period of time. But again, the fake news phenomenon really is starting to call into question, you know, everything that you read, everything that it's always been the case that there have been challenges about political leaders and institutions, but it just seems as if they're under much more assault, under veritable siege now because of what the tools of cyberspace, social media, and the internet make available.
So if I look around here, this is obviously a very civilized forum. We all sit here, we hardly interrupt each other. You could actually interrupt each other a little more.
Okay, let me try now.
Even Scott wears a tie. Many people in the audience wear a tie. It's a very civilized forum, and the whole Munich Security Conference is based on rules. You come together and you talk to each other and you behave in a very civilized way. Obviously, the people who are spreading fake news, who are spreading propaganda, who are using digital platforms to amplify that message, are not adhering to any kind of rules. So what is our leverage, Fiona, to win and to protect our institutions if they use our own tools? When I look at it, in the old days they used Pravda, which they made, and it was a poor product. Today, they use Twitter, which an American company, or they try to use or attack Google. They use Western products and turn them against us. What is our lever? Like, what can we do to protect our society?
Let me then interrupt. You asked for it.
Now you're interrupting the only lady on the forum.
Let's not forget that extremists are using cyberspace and the internet as well to proselytize, to pass instructions, to share tactics, techniques, and procedures on the use of explosives and small activities and so forth to recruit or inspire lone wolves and all the rest of this. And it is only now, it's taken far too long in my view for social media, internet service providers and others, and even with respect to Google, although again his organization with Jared Cohen at the helm and others really is starting to pioneer how you're going to deal with this. And actually, it has been done before. The way that child pornography has been largely eliminated from the internet, or at least dramatically reduced, is through the use of a variety of artificial intelligence tools that keep getting better and better and better. And now that there's pioneering work being done with that, that's more so on the social media providers, but internet service providers now also with search devices and how they respond to that are getting much more savvy as well. That's what has to be done, certainly, to counter the extremist use. The use of it, for, again, slightly tweaked or you know, you're just sort of putting a little bit of windage into your news or your pitch, or just flat out propaganda, I think that is actually much more challenging in a lot of ways. That's the new issue that has to be dealt with by, frankly, I think in particular, by those who are conveying the news and trying to figure out whether it's accurate, how do you fact check it, and so forth.
Julian, on.
Wait, no. Okay, now I have to interrupt. We cannot interrupt Fiona twice.
No.
Or you agree on Georg going first. Like, you could, no, let Fiona, you go first.
Well, it's probably just going to build on what General Petraeus said, because, you know, you mentioned Pravda, of course, which was the Russian for truth, which was a very important part of establishing a single information domain in the Soviet Union. And it had rules. So there actually are some rules to fake news, fake information, or propaganda. Pravda also carried a lot of real information. Now, sometimes, you know, that might have been in a very Soviet context about, you know, things that were not particularly very politically explosive. But the real weight of a piece of fake information takes advantage of the weight of other true pieces of information or objective facts around it. So the most effective disinformation or influence campaign comes amidst a host of other verifiable information. So you get trust in that piece of information. And what I was going to say was what Scott was talking about is extraordinarily vital, and this is also what General Petraeus was picking up on, to have tools that we can use to sift out that false information from among the actual accurate information is essential. I mean, coming from a think tank, you know, we write a lot of boring books at think tanks like mine, because we have to spend an awful lot of laborious time fact-checking everything. So when we write a book, you know, half the book is footnotes, which makes it a little tedious for people sitting in this audience. You know, we have a joke at Brookings that nobody can ever pick one up, let alone put it down, because we have so much of the fact-checking and the footnotes at the back. But it's very important to have that, because then if you do a shorter piece for a blog or, you know, you tweet out, you have a depth of information, and people can go back and say, well, where on earth did this person get this information from? Well, you can have a look at the 20,000 footnotes at the end and figure out where we got it, and you can check it yourself. Mm-hmm. Now, how much better to have this as a tool online? I think there'll be a period where actually people's sourcing, to the effect that you can actually do that, I mean, obviously some sourcing, particularly for journalism, and also for the intelligence services, one would expect not to have online, but you might be able to have a degree of information from the private sector and from the media, and people can actually go to and, you know, see how trustworthy this source is, because there's so much going around on the internet, including by individuals, that people don't know who, you know, who they are, what their background is on these kinds of issues, and so the kind of service that you're talking about, I mean, it might put fact checkers out of business, but all the better if we can actually have something that we can rely on, particularly in speed, because, you know, fact-checking, as you're pointing out, takes a lot of time, it's very laborious, people get very frustrated with it, and they don't wait to find out, you know, what the real background is to most of the stories that just run with them. And as we know from psychology, you know, once a piece of information has taken root in a person's head, whether it's true or not, it's incredibly difficult to dislodge it.
I want to ask the two Germans on the panel, Gerhard Conrad and Georg, and I need to ask you for a brief answer because we still want to open the floor for questions from the audience. What is coming at us in terms of disinformation and fake news in the upcoming elections this year in Germany, but also other elections in Europe, Mr. Conrad? What are you seeing?
Frankly speaking, very much. But again, not pointing a finger to anybody or any organization, because I point the finger to social media users as well. I may just recall the sad events here in Munich a few months ago when a single person committed an amok shooting spree here in your city, and you know best, all of you who are possibly living here, how the situation escalated via the social media for 3 hours. 3,500 police, if I'm not mistaken, or even more, had to be mobilized, in order to try to prevent fake events not being identified as such at the moment. It was, let's say, it looked as Mumbai-style terrorist attack in multiple places, at the Stachus, at the main station, and it was one single guy being seen by mostly, I assume, or everybody assumes, good-willing people. It was not a malicious attempt to create fake news, but there were a multitude of fake news spreading kind of terror. So this is another element which you can easily translate from a kind of single criminal act to other, events. And even now, if you have election campaigns or opinion building processes, we should not underestimate also this, autonomously generated, spontaneously generated kind of mood spreading, not being the event of or the result of a manipulation of some sort. So I would just add that and pass to Georg, maybe. And
yeah, because I'm not an official and I can answer the Russia question as good as I can. I have no doubt that there are very troubling events, that there is a lot of very bad and ugly reporting coming out of Russia or their substitutes who are based here in Germany, for example. I would be a little bit careful if I'm really convinced that there is this grand Putin Kremlin strategy that Trump should become the president, that Merkel has to lose in autumn. All this might well be, I don't know, but I was disappointed that the American government, Barack Obama in his last days, only gave very little details on what the intelligence community really found out, on what made them so convinced that it was a Russian attack. And I reported myself just a week ago that an investigation done by the German intelligence services here in Germany, ordered by the Chancellor herself, came up with an inconclusive conclusion, saying that it is highly probable that the Russians are interfering here, but that there is no proof. I have to say, I'm desperately waiting for Russian Edward Snowden, because I would love to hear and love to know what they're really doing.
But maybe Snowden is the Russian Edward Snowden.
Well, yeah, you're right. I wait for, thanks for correcting that. I'm not waiting for Edward Snowden coming out of Russia. I'm waiting for a real Russian Edward Snowden with inside knowledge of the Russian intelligence services. And let me make one more remark in my profession as a journalist, because I've hearing now a lot about if we need a new technology to counter fake news. I would say the technology is still there and working 24/7, and it's professional journalism. Mm-hmm. But I would also say that we have to do a better job. Sometimes we do, sometimes we don't. One thing is, has a lot to do with speed, since we have all this internet media, accuracy, fact-checking, sorry reporting, finding a second source. All these things are too often are no longer true. So Wolfgang Schäuble, one of the old hands in the German government, recently compared especially the internet media with the financial markets, always a little bit too nervous and jump on everything. I think somehow he is right. So what we have to gain and to regain as journalists is the trust of our audience, and this means they have to believe that we do our best, that we correct our mistakes, that we are reporting in their behalf, that we are not part of a far distanced elite. This is the most important thing. So, and this is why I believe that this might be a good moment for good journalism, and that we keep up our role. I mean, this is one has to be blind not to see that people are becoming more and more critical with journalists. But hopefully it's not that most of our audience, or most of our readers, are thinking as Agatha Christie once so famously said, "I never liked journalists, that's why they have died to die early in my books."
Well, but we are seeing, we are really seeing, despite all the doubt and all the skepticism and pessimism when it comes to the current political situation in the US, especially here in Germany, we really are seeing a new day, basically, for journalism. If I look at the circulation, the digital circulation of the New York Times, if I look at the great reporting coming out of the New York Times and the Washington Post, very critical on what is going on in this administration, I think lots of the doubt and the skepticism towards journalism, and if we really needed that, we've seen in the past months, is just being proven wrong these very days. But Scott, I know that you have brief point, because we really need more questions from the audience.
Brief, and to echo what you just said, Julian, 2016, at the tail end, was characterized by the fake news debate, no question about it, and it's bled into 2017 for sure. But it was also the year of the Panama Papers. And it was amazing to watch the Panama Papers spread across the globe. And if you go back, an unfiltered.news, and you go back and you just kind of follow the path of the Panama Papers across the globe and see, there are only two countries that didn't report on it. I'll leave it up to you to figure out which two they were. But it was amazing to see that news spread around the world. And so, like you, I'm not too pessimistic about this. I think that it's a question about how to help develop tools to help accelerate what journalists already do, and also to think about how we invest in those publishing platforms in a way that can help them do better. And I know, like, the Digital News Initiative that Google's working with European publishers is hopefully part of that.
Yep. Sorry, you wanted to?
First of all, I think the Washington Post, New York Times, and Post in particular, with the fact-checking and the awarding of Pinocchios and all the rest of this, I think is very, very effective. And they're now literally doing it real time. So if there's a campaign speech, if there's something else that really matters, you can actually follow digitally as they are fact-checking what has just been said. And it's really quite remarkable. So it's really, I think, how do they evolve? Wikipedia. I remember that my site, for example, used to be a battleground. I mean, one day the critics would have their way with it, and it was as if they took graffiti and put all over it, and then unknown supporters would, you know, correct it all and go embellish it too far the other way, probably. And ultimately, they started locking down sites. I think mine was one of the first 10, actually, at that time. It was during the surge or right after. And all of a sudden, there was an actual referee process. They have to have sources. I think it has really evolved in a very impressive manner, and it gives you a degree of trust in that. So I think we're seeing this kind of process, procedure, and technique evolve. And it's the question of how do you continue to do that? How do you foster it further? And how do you keep up with the pace of what goes on in social media in particular?
Thank you very much for that. Now, well, I apologize to the audience for not giving you more time, but I think we had so many interesting things here that I just was very hard to intervene with everything they said. So do we have any questions from you two? Yes, please, briefly, gentleman with the white shirt and with a black beard. Yes, right there.
Hi.
Maybe briefly introduce yourself and ask your question. Oh, you have a microphone.
Absolutely. My name is Sergei Rontegi. I come from Mexico, work for a German company. My question is for General Petraeus. You mentioned at the beginning of your intervention that one of the biggest vulnerabilities that we're facing now is regarding critical infrastructure supported by ICS, SCADA systems. My question is, how's your assessment about how developed and how mature the technology is nowadays to protect these systems in the digital era? We're seeing these systems connected to the internet. We're seeing the Internet of Things growing up faster and faster, and this is overwhelming. How prepared are we to to tackle this in the digital world?
I think there's an enormous race to catch up on the Internet of Things, actually. I think that may be one of the biggest vulnerability that's out there. What you have is a phenomenon of lots of little gadgets, and we all probably have them and don't even realize that we're... And very few of these went through the kind of development that a major device from a Google or a Microsoft or Apple or something like that would go through, and they're racing to compete to get out there. Again, these are all little new ideas to how you can tap back into your house to see what the air conditioner is doing or start the stove or do a variety of other tactics issues. And frankly, they're very vulnerable. But the vulnerability that I was highlighting earlier is the one that has to do with the industrial control systems that are, again, that operate our electrical grid and water systems in particular. In many cases, there's only less than 15 major types of these. I'm now actually in the cybersecurity world from the investment side. I'm actually invested in an industrial control system cybersecurity startup, and they're racing to build these out as quickly as they can. And again, it is a race to catch up. So yes, there's a race to catch up on the Internet of Things. That is important, in part because you can actually harness the Internet of Things devices very, very easily. That is, again, a great source of soldiers in these denial of service attacks. Much more worrisome is how quickly we can fix the cybersecurity vulnerabilities in the industrial control system, especially when it comes to non-state actors, in particular extremists, who will not be deterred in the same way that nation-state actors might be, who have their own ICS challenges, who have their own return address. And this is a big vulnerability and a big worry.
And what also may make us vulnerable is the laziness of the digital age. I, 2 days ago, installed Amazon Alexa in my office. Is it called? It's called Alexa in German.
Yeah.
And it's a device that is always listening.
Yeah.
And I installed it in my office because it's very convenient. And then I had a sensitive meeting and I thought, well, you know, 2 years ago, it would have been a nightmare vision to install something in your office that is listening to everything you say and where they tell you that it only, you know, activates when you say that one word. But, you know, first of all, it's listening. And that is something that possibly makes us vulnerable. But do we have any more questions?
Thank you, sir.
Here, second row, right in front of me.
Hello, my name is Wolfgang Strauch. I'm from Germany. One question is, we talked about reestablishing truth or trust in institutions, and I consider the internet the internet companies also institutions. Mm. And we see that the doubt is growing about news coming from internet companies like I name Facebook, especially. Do you think, Mr. Carpenter, that the internet companies must engage in reestablishing trust in their business model?
Well, I obviously can't speak for other companies.
Although it would be interesting.
Although it would be fascinating, I can guarantee you.
I consider Google News also because...
So first of all, for Google, let's say, our business really relies on trust, and it really relies on our micro relationships with you as an individual, right? And so I do think that we're doing a lot to try to address some of these challenges as I've described. If you look at Google News, there are 75,000 news sources that are included in Google News. Just to tell you, that's not all of the organizations out there who claim to be news organizations, right? So there are criteria that we use to think through, like who is included in that search for news, which I think is an important thing. It's not everyone. And to General Petraeus' point, is that that's evolved. We're evolving this as we go in response, oftentimes, to governments, but more importantly and most urgently to our users. And I think that that's where a lot of this has to begin, to understand what are you concerned about? What are you looking for? We want these services to be useful to you. That's why we're building them. And in this area, I think that, again, part of it is what the technology can bring, but a lot of it has to do with how we as individuals in our democracies are evolving along with the technology. Like, one of the things I think about, I don't know if you have the equivalent of American Idol in Europe, but...
Oh, we do.
It's jarring when you think about from a user's point of view that they are able to take text a vote to an organization to make something actually happen in the world, and yet the systems that we have in place for how we govern ourselves are not that immediate for very good reasons. But that friction is frustrating to a lot of younger people. I can make these decisions so quickly. I can get all this information I need. I can convey it to whoever I want. And yet, to communicate with, let's say, the commission, or to a member of Congress even, is difficult. There's friction there. And so part of it is, how do we begin to use these tools to also help eliminate some of that friction, so that people can communicate more easily with one another? That's far off, but to the point that General Petraeus is making, we are evolving with the technology, and the company is evolving in response to you as well.
Georg, were you...
Yeah, just a footnote. And when we started here, I have said that I like these kind of discussions, because now we are getting serious on the challenges. And I think part of it is that for too long, at least some of the huge internet companies were convinced that their technology is only a gigantic benefit for the world, which undoubtedly it is. But it comes with a downside. And I think during the past months, we see that the technological companies are recognizing it. They are recognizing their own duties in all that. They are rethinking certain policies they had. Facebook, for example. And I think it's a good part of the discussion we are having now, because I believe you have this responsibility.
So walking in here, I've heard the word Haxe quite a lot from the audience, so I guess many people want to go for dinner. So I will, one more question back there. Right, yeah.
Hello, my name is Abigail Rikas. I'm a lecturer at the University of Augsburg, and my question has to do with the freedom of expression. We've been talking about fake news, which I think everyone agrees is a bad thing. But how do we determine what's fake news and what is legitimate speech? Because there are organizations, particularly The Onion, when I'm thinking about it, that walk that fuzzy line between fake news and legitimate speech. And that's to anyone who wants to answer it.
So who's first?
You know, there's a phenomenon that I don't think is just unique to the United States, but it is one where universities are getting so sensitive to the potential for essentially unrest that if an individual is invited to a university and there's some segment from one side or the other that objects, then either the university pulls the plug, or in some cases, the individuals pull the plug. And this, I think this is getting a bit more worrisome myself. I am personally sensitive to this kind of stuff. I've been essentially harassed in the streets of New York when I was my greeting as the first day of a professor at the City University of New York Honors College. Now, I've faced lots of demonstrators over the years, But it's a very different thing when you have security and there's an advanced team and they say, oh, can you go in past them or whatever it is. It's very different if there is not that. And also just, you know, why subject yourself to that? And I see that as a very worrisome trend. It's a little bit different than what the questioner had in mind, I think. But it is something that is part and parcel of all of what's going on now. It's sort of the real world manifestation of what goes on in the internet with trolling or these other sort of attacks that take place there. And I think that's something that, again, universities are gonna have to come to grip with in particular, because I think they're the places which should be open to freedom of expression, but also do have a responsibility to maintain order and discipline, if you will. And so they're gonna have to, that will have to evolve as well over time and figure out how they can do that.
Fiona, you look like you want to add something to that.
This is actually, I mean, a multi-layered question, just like an onion that you mentioned. Because it's also, you know, fake news has become a kind of a way of actually conveying real news as well, in the sense of thinking about what used to be the Jon Stewart show, and now John Oliver, The Onion, you know, many of the other satirical Punch in the UK was one of the first that did this. You know, kind of making
not
it
forget
humorous.
Saturday Night Live.
Exactly.
Right now.
I wasn't going to mention that, given how contentious it's become recently. But I mean, this is also conveying a real kind of sense of information and about the big debates. And I think the message of your question there is an incredibly important one. I mean, especially actually sitting here in Germany, which is a country that over its entire history, because the history of World War II and then the history of division and the history of having East Germany, that you've battled with this in many different ways. I mean, obviously, Holocaust denial is against the law here. In some places, people are insisting that that's actually part of free speech, and you have to have a big debate about that. You know, how do you control or talk about the information space in a reasonable way? How do you get rules that can take off the edge of what is actually very harmful speech and that might not be in the public good to have certain things debated? I mean, this gets to the heart of what you're talking about. And how do you then get into a much more flourishing environment, be it in universities, in settings like this, in think tanks, in the media? I mean, obviously, you have the opinion pages, you have commentary. I think this is just a really difficult decision for us, a set of discussions. And it was incredibly important against the backdrop of what happened with Charlie Hebdo, which obviously was one of the most extreme examples of attacks on free speech. And I think this is also very much at the heart of this debate. This panel is obviously not going to be able to bring it out there, but I think it was very important for you to raise that from the floor. And perhaps over the course of this conference and as we all go out of here, we can really be taking this debate forward. Because that's also the heart of getting the truth back again, and also to get trust in institutions, that we can also use humor, and that we can also say what we need to say, what we want to say, but in a format, forum and in a format in which that doesn't really do severe harm to others.
It really was an important and great question, and I think it kind of summarizes why this is such a great event, because the foundation of our kind of societies is these kind of events where we come together and have an open debate and share thoughts about how we can defend our liberal democracies against those threats while adhering and sticking to the rules. So that's what I'm taking from tonight. And unfortunately, we have to call it a day now or a debate now. Another thing I'm really taking is what you said, that we can never be lazy in the search for truth, even if the world becomes so convenient and we have such great tools, we can never become lazy. And the third thing is also from you, that it's a privilege to get that message that a state actor is trying to hack into your into your Gmail account. So I feel like I'm on like the new status symbol of the fake news era now.
Print it out, frame it, put it on your wall.
So thank
Come back
you
when
everyone
you've actually been hacked.
Well, so thank you very much. You're still ahead of me. Thank you very much for being here tonight. I hope all of you have a great and inspiring conference. It was great to have you here. It was an honor to be your host. So to say thank you very much for coming tonight. Enjoy your steak or haxe or the beautiful weather outside. And have a great MSC in 2017. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you, sir.